That's okay.
So first I would like to introduce the Judy Collins.
Yay! Hooray!
Judy comes to us from here in the South, from Alabama, from the Vine and Fig Tree community, and she's going to open the panel with a song.
And the song came to me, can you hear?
Yes.
When I was at Kings Bay, Georgia. How many people know what else is at Kings Bay? I've been with some of these folks here when we had Feast of the Holy Innocents and Nagasaki Day demonstrations, and always out at the Trident Submarine Base saying no. So, this is what really happened. It was Nagasaki Day. I was at King's Bay, and I heard the cry of a mourning dove.
Subrata Ghosh-Roy, a professionally an engineer who worked for many years in defense research. He also worked as a congressional staffer. He later worked as a senior analyst with the Government Accountability Office, where he distinguished himself as the first ever whistleblower. He's currently on the research faculty at MIT, and he will be joining us today from via Skype.
Interrupt me at 15. I've titled today's talk as missile defense program, how we got to where we are today. As in the introduction, you have heard that I have distinguished myself as the first whistleblower and first ever whistleblower in the at the General Accounting Office on this issue of missile defense. In the 85-year history of GAO, nobody had blown the whistle. At that time, I'm 85 years, so it's now getting close to the century. Nobody has done such a thing. Okay, so what do I want to talk about today? Just a brief history of the GME program, evolution from Reagan's Star Wars to Obama's phased adaptive approach. Why GME has such sustaining power despite the controversy, despite the technical problems that you have heard about over the years. And then I'll talk a little bit about the specific instance of my whistleblowing, what it is about, and why I, because it has got the Huntsville link. So quickly, even though it's a very knowledgeable audience, I take it people who are in our network know and hear about missile defense and space weaponization a lot to our newsletter and other meetings and conferences. But regardless, it probably is a good idea to just set a stage for what it is that we are talking about. So I would say that missile defense is all about nuclear supremacy. That it's a political program that has very little technical basis, but its roots go back to the days when the U.S. had its nuclear weapons arsenal so much bigger than the USSR. And when the USSR intercontinental ballistic missile programs caught up with the technology and launched the Sputnik, that put the fear in the U.S. military that they really wanted to have supremacy with the nuclear arsenal. For that, they wanted to stop the Soviet missiles from landing in the U.S. mainland. And that sort of driver of supremacy today, although we talk about three different things under Reagan, that this is the peace shield if you have anti-ballistic missile. So, so that was the main driver, and during the Cold War, both USSR and the United States tried different technologies for missile defense, and both countries deployed missile defense systems, the U.S. in Grand Forks in North Dakota, and the Soviet Union at the mosque of ABM. And very soon it was realized that these things were not feasible, and it led to farther arms race. And so missile defense systems were quickly abandoned in the 60s, although the Moscow ABM is still there, a very old system, but the U.S. rapidly dismantled its system after one day of operation in North Dakota. And so what we saw at that time was this deployment of systems that would have nuclear-tipped interceptors for interception of missiles in the terminal phase, meaning a missile that has been coming from the Soviet Union, and at that time only the Soviet Union had the capability of launching these types of missiles, that they would be intercepted at their terminal phase, meaning these missiles have gone in their trajectory over thousands of miles, and actually re-enter the atmosphere. And it's after the re-entry, this is the terminal phase where they would be intercepted with nuclear interceptor. So this was obviously seen to be a completely manned system to have nuclear interceptor to intercept nuclear missiles. And then the cost, of course, is prohibitive. And the resulting arms race, meaning that if you can stop somebody's missiles, then the adversary would, of necessity, try to increase its offensive capability to overcome your defensive system. The arms race was really getting out of control until the realization set in that we need to have some control on these things. And so 1972, lo and behold, it was actually Richard Nixon, who was the president, signed the anti-ballistic missile treaty with Brezhnev, the Soviet president. And that treaty lasted for over 30 years and really kept peace in between the two superpowers. That situation changed, although the ABM treaty was not abandoned by the US until 2002. Reagan, of course, started in 1983, again, this business of missile defense, and portrayed himself as the peacemaker that will stop all nuclear missiles with our missile shield, so there'd be no necessity of nuclear weapons. But the Soviets did not buy that argument, and again, they saw it as a defense and gaining, that if you can stop Soviet missiles, then it may again have the capacity of a first strike to decapitate the Soviet Union. So even though Gorbachev agreed with Reagan that the elimination of all nuclear weapons in Reykjavik, in the eventually the U.S. backed out because Gorbachev also demanded that we abandon our missile defense. But one other point, so this is the Cold War history of missile defense, which was primarily stopping missiles that were intercontinental in nature, 5,000-6,000 miles in their range. But this situation changed after 1991, the first Gulf War. The first Gulf War had Saddam Hussein attack the U.S. forward deployed troops in Saudi Arabia with the Soviet supplied Scud missiles. For the first time, there was actually a large number of U.S. soldiers who were killed by this attack by Saddam. So this led to growth of this new paradigm of missile defense program. This is now 1991. It is the beginning of the crumbling of the Soviet Union, total new shift in the world balance of power, and again the clamor now for missile defense. So all that thing about ABM treaty stopping missile defense programs, people who are true believers in this in the supremacy and the missile defense as a part and parcel of that continued from all these years, and Reagan really now gave them all the necessary impetus to go forward with developing systems and sort of chipping away at the ABM treaty. And so they were talking about that this is definitely not in the U.S. national security interest to continue with the ABM treaty. And so after 1991, it really became very clear that the U.S. wanted to abandon the ABM treaty. And I was in Congress working on the House Armed Services Committee.
5 minutes, in please. 90s.
And when this business of missile defense came up in a big way with the Republican victory in the 1994 election, so the Newt Gingrich revolution, with a platform that that the Republicans were determined to deploy missile defense systems, even though it was going to be a violation of the ABM Treaty, etc. And they cut eventually a deal with the Democrats, and that's how it happened. So now the current system are, of course, multifold. We are continuing to develop, as you very well know, the intercontinental ballistic missile system, which is called the TMD, the ground-based mid-course, where you intercept missiles in the mid-course in the exo-atmosphere, meaning in the space outside the atmosphere. And then we have the several other systems, what they call the lower tier systems, because they call it a tiered. And you have heard from Dave, I believe, on the technical nature of all these systems, so I don't have either time or a place to talk about that now. But I just simply will list the programs that currently are under development. So we have the US GMD, as I just mentioned. We are deploying in Alaska and in California a limited number of system interceptors. We have, of course, the European phased adaptive approach, which has both land-based missile interceptors and Aegis-based interceptors in the Baltic, in the Baltic Sea, and other places. And then we have Patriot Advanced Capability PAC systems that are deployed for short-range missiles, and we have deployed them many places around the world, in Japan, in the Middle East, and Israel, and Turkey, and then the fact that you have heard so much about the second tier system. It used to be called Theater High Altitude Area Defense. Now it's called Terminal Minimum. Same system, but more powerful than PAC, the capabilities of the radar and the interceptor. And then we also are experimenting with the boost phase system. A boost phase system is primarily a system that attacks the adversary's missiles in the boost phase, meaning when the missile is still under pressure, and the rocket engine is still firing as it is rising to our atmosphere. So this boost phase system was abandoned. Many systems were tried, primarily laser phase. And I was one of the principal investigators of the program called the Airborne Laser, which was a boost phase system that was going to be based with a very high power laser on a Boeing 747 called the Airborne Laser. It was a complete fiasco, complete technical failure, and the system was abandoned in 2009. And so right now, at least no laser-based systems are being considered viable for the time being. But the true believers in the laser weapons continue to push, and it is happening. And the other systems are the Israeli BMD system with our close collaboration, and the BMD systems in India that are also, we also have working groups with the Indians. One of the things that characterize all of this is the politics of missile defenses. I quickly go to that now, is this complete lack of independent testing. It's a very highly complicated technical system, but many of its components, let alone the system itself, are hard to test because it's so expensive, and the integration of the system is so difficult, and there is no independent testing to speak of right now. They have done a really interesting thing. They have categorized the missile defense system as exempt from federal acquisition regulations called the FAR. And these acquisition regulations are detailed regulations that control the development of the major weapon systems. And if you don't follow these regulations, then it is very difficult to have oversight and accountability. So as a former investigator at GAO, I was very familiar with this thing. And Rumsfeld, when he became the Secretary of Defense, exempted Mr. MPA from FAR regulations. They also, interestingly enough, you know that they categorize this whole BNB program, it's a very large program, $10 billion every year that are spent on these aspects of the program. And they are categorized simply as a research and development program, not a production program, because there are very limited quantities, but as sometimes like to put up the research and development if we are deploying this as actual working weapon system. But there is a catch. If we want to go to the production, these programs have to pass an independent operational testing. And by leaving it in the R&D, you don't have to do that testing. So there is no testing. It's testing. Results are often very much glorified, and my whistleblowing is all about that. And there is also another very key thing. They have thrown away what is called in the Pentagon the ORD, which stands for Operational Requirement Document. Because it's an exempt program, it doesn't have any operational requirements document. So it's called capabilities-based system. You can just do whatever you want. You can demonstrate whatever a Rumsfeld had said. Well, something is better than nothing. Well, something is better than nothing. When you spend $10 million, there better be some. There's almost nothing there. Just a few words about what happened with my case, the whistleblowing. So I was at GAO, as a senior analyst and investigator, because I was technical, my background and I had congressional experience, this was a very complex situation with somebody from Boeing had blown the whistle on a particular computer algorithm that was key to the working of the GNP system and a software. And she had blown the whistle, the software was not working, and they were, Boeing and TRW, who were claiming that it worked. So there was a test in 1997, and that test was the first test for this system. So it was very critical. It was the beginning of a large ramp up funding, and they wanted to make sure people understood that the technology was there, no problems with the technology. And they tested it, and the test was a complete failure. And this woman, engineer, Dr. Ira Schwartz from TRW, had blown the whistle. She was promptly fired, and GAO was asked by a congressman from California, where TRW is located in Los Angeles, to investigate this. So I was the lead investigator for this. That lasted from 2000 to 2002, and the test was in 1997. And after reviewing all the documents, secret documents, 2 years, meeting all the people with Boeing, TRW, at the Pentagon, many, many meetings in Huntsville, because the program was in Huntsville, because there was an Army program. So I spent many, many hours in Huntsville working with the program manager, looking through the data, talked about problems and so forth. So eventually when I wrote my report and said the test had actually completely failed, and so GAO did not want to come up with the report because there was immense pressure from the Pentagon on GAO. Now, notice that GAO is the congressional watchdog, that it is supposed to keep watch on this various programs at the Pentagon that cost so much money, but GAO was so much influenced at that time by the Republican Congress and Pentagon that they didn't want to go with the report. So I eventually decided to get the public, wrote a 42-page letter to Congress, Congressman Berman, at the specific, and it was published, a news report was published in the New York Times in April, April 2nd, 2006, about that. But nothing happened. So this, this just continued. I mean, this is the big money pit, as you all may know. During the Star Wars years, we spent $100 million on this program. And since 2001, since Bush and then Obama, we have spent $170 million. It's 10 billion, it's a simple math, 10 billion a year, 17 years, 170 billion, and 100 billion before. So close to $300 billion spent on this program that has used no technology, very little science, but it continues with bipartisan congressional support. So it is very difficult to get traction, even for people like me who were working in Congress on GAO and had a sort of unique background to blow on this program. After my whistleblowing, the Congress, nothing. There was no hearing, no nothing. The matter just simply died, and we just keep on spending money.
Super Actor, so we have to stop now.
But I should end here because I'm over time. So thank you very much.
Thank you. So I would now like to introduce Bruce Gagnon, who is the coordinator of the Global Network. He's a Vietnam-era veteran and a member of VFP. He lives in Bath, Maine.
Okay, if you get cut off, I'll...